Turn from 1 Kings to the right to the book of Job, and we're going to look at the first two chapters. As we look at the book of Job, I want you to see that the whole book of Job is built around this single concept that God on the throne wants Job in the ashes of his troubles to see them through the frame. That's how the book opens and closes. You understand that? The book of Job opens and closes around the throne. All of our life is lived from beginning to end through that lens of God sitting on the throne. As we look at Job's woes and troubles, we have to understand that the events of our lives, too, are carried out in front of the same scene of God's power. It isn't like the Lord just turned this thing on for Micaiah and he turns it on for Job. You understand, it's happening now, right now. This is going on. We're sitting. The Lord's watching you in church. I don't have to. You know, someone just sent me an email this week, and they said, you weren't interesting until 10 minutes in. I was working on my phone until then, and then I started paying attention. I thought, thanks for telling me. You know, it doesn't matter. The Lord watches. See, we answer to him, not to each other. And so he's watching us right now. And from Job 1 and 2, here's what he wants us to see. Trust the one who's seated on the throne. Trust the one who's watching everything. Trust the one who's listening to everything. Trust the one who has all the hosts of heaven under his control. Trust the one who is orchestrating all the events. Trust him. Now, if I could do a quick synopsis of the 42 chapters of Job, it would be this. You know, how they have the big title on a book and they have the little title. The little title, you know, the big title is the book of Job. The little title is, you're all part of something that is incredibly bigger than you realize. Or I could put it this way, you're all into something that's much bigger than you think. In other words, what Job does is it says that you and I are not just merely one little life that lives, you know, 74.7 years or however our life expectancy has gotten to be in America, and just works through life all by himself, and everything I do only matters to the people that know me, and there aren't very many of those, and everyone will forget me, and I'll be gone. No. The Lord says you're part of something much bigger than that. That every day you and I are part of God orchestrating glory to his name as he watches over his word to perform it. And we're part of the cast of the performing of the word. There is a cosmic struggle going on between the God of the universe, who does not force us to do what he wants, and between the God of this world, who will do anything to frustrate what God is trying to stream into our lives. The problem is a lot of the cast members aren't listening, and a lot of the cast members aren't reading the script, and a lot of the cast members aren't doing what the king left them to do. See, that's what the whole book of Job is about. The throne is set in heaven. It's been there overshadowing all of human events since creation, but God is not just sitting there and watching like a game on TV munching. You know, he's not kicked back watching it play. But God is always depicted as actively involved. He's in the affairs of mankind. He's ruling. He's reigning. Never out of touch. Never out of control. That's huge. The Lord now shows us this scene. And this was broadcast by God to show us an event that took place between Noah and Abraham. That's where most Bible scholars place this. Job's life is somewhere between Noah at the end of the flood and Abraham at the beginning of the nation of Israel. So somewhere in those couple hundred years, there we find Job. And so this event was broadcast by God for us to see the big picture of the God we can trust, the one on the throne. Because he knows us and protects us, but our concept of him knowing and protecting needs to be adjusted by this frame. Because what he allows is not what we would want. That's why we have to trust him. See, it all connects together. And the whole book of Job ends with Job summarizing what he learned. You know what it says in Job 42, 5 and 6? He says, God, I've heard of you by the hearing of the ear, but now I see you, and I repent in dust and ashes. Basically, Job says, I've heard all about you. By the way, he was a great guy. He was raising his family right. He was praying for him. He was sacrificing the Lord. He knew the Lord. He knew the word of the Lord, and he was a righteous man. But he says, Lord, I knew all of that kind of at an arm's length. I was acquainted with you. But going through what I just went through for 42 chapters, now I know you. And what he said is, now I can really see you. And that was the goal God had. God wanted Job to see the one on the throne was the one he could trust. Not just in a Sunday school lesson he heard it. He wanted to have him experience it. And see, that's what glorifies God. Not when we watch a moving presentation and hear some truth and say, oh, that's neat. It's when we live that out in our daily lives and experience it. Okay, real quickly, let's look at Job 1 and 2. And what I'm going to show you is the big picture, what's going on up above, and then I'm going to show you the ground picture, the lesson that's learned. Okay, and so first of all, the big picture is the one seated on the throne stays in touch with our lives. So you start following along in your Bible, and I'm going to read Job 1. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was blameless and upright, and one who feared God and shunned evil. And 7 sons and 3 daughters were born to him. Okay, look up. You know what that means? God knows all about Job. I mean, he knows where he lives, he knows his family, he knows all of his kids, he knows everything about him. He knows the Lord is in touch. He knows Job, everything about him. That's not all he knows. Look at verse 3. And his possessions were 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, and a very large household. So this man was the greatest of all his people in the east. You know what else the Lord knows? He knows all of our possessions. Isn't that interesting? He was better than the IRS. He couldn't hide anything from the Lord. He knows exactly everything that Job owned and possessed. I mean, right down to the female donkeys. I mean, I always think that's so amazing. Were there no males? You know, I mean, what's going on here? Is he prejudiced, you know, and discriminatory? But the Lord knew all of his possessions, and that's why we should never worry about what other people give or don't give, because it doesn't matter, because the Lord is the one that knows exactly how much we have and whether what we give him is a proportionate reflection of his blessing or a stingy response that I need to do something, so I'm going to do something. See, that the Lord doesn't measure the amount we give, he measures the cost, because he knows what we have and he sees what we give in proportion to how he's blessed us. But keep reading with the story. It's just amazing. And his sons, verse 4, would go out and feast in their houses each an appointed day, and they would send and invite 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. And so it was when the days of feasting had run their course that Job would send and sanctify them. He would rise early in the morning and offer burnt sacrifices according to the number of them all. For Job said in his heart that it may be my sons have sinned and cursed God in their heart. And thus Job did regularly. Now here's truth for us. Number one, God was tracking with everything going on in Job's life. He knew where the kids were. He knew how they related. He knew how Job parented and was a spiritual head and prayed for his family. The Lord's tracking with all this. So that's the first thing. Second thing, starting in verse 6, here's the second big picture. The one seated on the throne regulates the adversary of all God's people named Satan. In fact, Satan is the Hebrew word for adversary. So Satan is the adversary. And God regulates him. Look at his regulation, verse 6. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. Whoa. And Satan also came up among them. Now here is a fascinating verse. This is again, the Bible calls angels the sons of God. They were singing at creation. Here again, this is not people, this is angelic creatures are coming to present themselves before the throne of God. You know what that means? That means there's appointments up there. And it means that things are regulated. And it's just not, you know, it's like this. And guess who has access? Demons and Satan. See, they're not just off on their own, doing their own thing, just whatever they want. God is regulating Satan in his activities. In fact, if we ever get to Revelation 12, do you know what it says there? You know, there's the progressive revelation of the Bible that sometimes God just tells us a little bit and he just keeps adding to it all the way through the Bible. Do you know what it says in Revelation 12 about Satan? It says Satan is the one who is the accuser of the saints. Satan doesn't just stand up there leaning on the throne, you know, watching everything. He is accusing. In fact, his name means slanderer. Do you know what diabolus, the devil means slanderer? He is a slanderous accuser. That's why gossip is so bad. Whenever people gossip and accuse and slander, they are using the Greek word for the devil. That's what deviled tongues are, slanderers. They're just like the devil. That's why the Lord says in Titus, remember we covered it, don't do that. Don't be like Satan. So he's up there. And the Lord said to Satan, verse 7, where do you come? So Satan answered and said, from going to and fro throughout the earth and walking back and forth on it. Now look up for a minute. Peter talks about that, doesn't he? He says, for your adversary, Satan, the devil, the accuser, is like a what? Roaring lion. And he's prowling around seeking whom he may devour. See, there's such congruence to the Bible. It all fits together. And so here we see that picture. And verse 8, and then the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, a blameless, an upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil? Here's a truth for us. This is a hard one. God prompted the devil's attack on Job. Satan didn't bring up Job. Who brought Job up? Who made him a target? God. He says, hey, prowler, hey, roaring lion, hey, accuser. Have you checked that one out? Why? Why? Sitting in the grandstands here, we'd go, that doesn't... You know, most people have trouble with that. They almost think that there's an Old Testament God, you know, this Canaanite exterminator. I mean, he just goes out and exterminates Canaanites. And he kills all the firstborn children in Egypt, and he drowns whole armies, and he incinerates. And so that's the Old Testament God. Liberalism, mainline denominations, follow this. You know, that's the Old Testament God, but in the New Testament, we have Jesus. And he wouldn't hurt a fly. And his heavenly Father is watching the sparrows and the lilies. It's kind of like Colonel Sanders, you know? He just, but in Revelation, we get back to that one. Stay away from Revelation and the Old Testament and just stay with Jesus, you know. And so that's around us. And so people are shy of Revelation and they can't understand how the kind, you know, Jesus could possibly incinerate Canaanites, you know. And so we just comfortably leave everything alone. You just don't mess with it. But see, what's so interesting is, If you understand the throne, all of a sudden you get a frame around all this and everything fits inside. So what is going on here? Well, look at verse 9. So Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made a hedge around him and all his household and all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands and his possessions have increased in the land. Basically what he's saying is two things I hope that you really hold on to. Number one is anything good in their life, every good and perfect thing comes from God, and any blessing in their life is from him. Secondly, we are completely sealed and kept from any demonic intrusion into our life by the power of God. Now, Paul tells us in Ephesians that there are things we can do that unlocks the door to the devil. There's a whole list of them. And it leaves room for the devil in our life to attack and to do bad things. But if we are yielded to him and making choices obediently in step with the Spirit, we're really hedged. It's wonderful. But keep reading. So what the devil says in verse 11 is, so stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and surely he'll curse you to your face. In other words, he's saying he's only liking you because you're giving him stuff. And the Lord said to him, behold, instead of me doing it, behold, all that he has is in your power. Only don't lay a hand on his person. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. This is amazing. This is an amazing event. Here's the truth. Satan wants to make God's servants dishonor their king on the throne. Do you understand? All of life is lived, even now, with us, at work, at school, at home, on the road. All of life is playing out with Satan and his minions wanting to get us to dishonor the king on the throne. Do you remember what happened with David and Bathsheba? David should have gone to war, but he didn't. He was looking over the railing at his neighbor's wife taking a bath. And you know the whole event. Do you know the end of the event? Well, do you remember what the prophet Nathan said? He says, "You have caused the enemies of the Lord to rejoice. The hosts of heaven were gathered. God is watching. And he's pouring out his grace, and he's sending person after person to David saying, David, that's not your wife. David, are you sure you should be doing this? David, you shouldn't invite her over here to the castle. David, you should be on the warfare. You should not be peeking at her in her bath time." God sent all those warnings to David, and David chose to not obey. See, the whole Bible is filled with God does not force us to do what he wants. David chose to disobey. And you know what Nathan said? As the hosts of heaven were watching from the throne, guess who's over here going, rejoicing. You've caused the enemies of the Lord to rejoice because you've sinned. That's Satan's purpose. But let's go back to verse 13. Here's the big picture again. The one seated on the throne allowed Job to lose his property and children, not as a judgment, not as a penalty, not as God saying he shouldn't be rich. The big picture is God allowed Job to lose everything. Starting in verse 13, there was a day when his sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house, and a messenger came and said to Job, "The oxen were plowing and the donkeys feeding, and the Sabaeans raided them and took them all away, and they killed your servants, and I alone escaped." Here's a little truth. Satan can incite what we would call terrorists. The Sabaeans, Satan didn't do this, the Sabaeans did it. Why did they do it? Satan prompted them to do it. There is a lot, remember Satan came to kill and steal and destroy? Do you think all the wicked dictators and murderous people throughout history thought of all that themselves? Satan incites killing, stealing, destroying. And then verse 16, while they were still speaking, another came and said, "The fire of God fell from heaven and burned up the sheep." You know what? Satan can send fire from the sky. How do we know that? He did it right here. How do we know it's really, really? Because he's going to do it again in Revelation. One of the ways the Antichrist rules the world is he's going to have a false prophet that can call down fire by asking Satan to send down fire from heaven on his command. That is amazing to think about the spiritual realm like that. Verse 17, while they're still speaking, another came, and you know that he said, by verse 19, a great wind came from across the wilderness, struck the four corners of the house, it fell on young people, and they're dead. Did you know what this says? Satan can send horribly destructive weather, and that sounds like a tornado. Just, you understand that? He's the prince of the power of the air. He's the god of this world. He has incredible powers over the people to incite evil. He has great power over nature. He's the one that tried to drown Jesus in the boat. I mean, you talk about flagrant attacks. Here's the Creator himself in a boat, and Satan tries to send a storm and swamp the boat and drown Jesus. If Satan will try to drown Jesus, can you imagine what he might try and do to us? You understand? He has great power. Okay, verse 20. Here's another big picture. The one seated on the throne is listening to the cries of our heart through all this stuff. And so Job arose, tore his robe. I mean, he didn't just sit there and say, this is interesting. He got involved. He arose. He tore his robe. He shaved his head. He fell on the ground, and he worshiped. And he said, "Naked came I from my mother's womb. Naked shall I return there. The Lord gave. The Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Verse 22, and all this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrong. Here's a lesson. God was magnified through Job's cries, through his... I mean, Job didn't say, "This feels great, oh, I love it." No, he wept, he cried, he moaned. But he chose to not sin against the Lord. You understand? The devil wants to incite us to not listen, to not watch, to not see life the right way, to not obey, to not sync our lives with the Lord, so that he can dishonor through us the Lord. It's called grieving the Lord. It's called disobeying him. It dishonors him. Keep going. Next big picture. Look at chapter 2. The one seated on the throne allowed Job to suffer intensely bad times. I don't want to read all this. Go down to verse 7. Job went out from the presence of the Lord and struck Job with painful boils. So Satan comes, strikes Job with painful boils from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. Wow. Here's a little on-the-ground truth from that. Bad things can happen to good people in order for them to glorify the Lord. That's what Job's all about. Bad things happen to a good fellow. God starts out saying he's blameless, upright, fears the Lord, and follows me. So none of that awful stuff happened because he was bad, disobedient, rebellious, out of step with the Lord. All that happened so God would be glorified. Can you see? If you don't understand that, you really have a problem. You say, what are you doing, Lord? What are you doing, Lord? But if you have that perspective, that the one on the throne can be trusted.